Back in studio with our defense correspondent Daniel Tsemach and Dr. Yossi Beilin, a former justice minister of Israel, longtime negotiator, one of the key negotiators, in fact, of the Oslo Accords. So, Yossi, I want to ask you about the argument many are making that this proves for Hamas that violence works. Only after dozens of rockets were launched, only after Israelis got hurt, only now did the negotiations really ramp up, and there is now perhaps going to be a shipping route opening up between Cyprus and Gaza. For Hamas, it proves at some point violence must continue to be the plan.
Well, this is historically true. In a way, you may say about many events, not only in our Israeli-Arab conflict, but in the world conflicts, in the international conflicts, that force is a very important variable in these games. So this is not new, and this is a fact of life, regretfully. It doesn't mean that you always win because you are using power, but it means that when you use power, it is significant, and the other side must react to it this way or another. The main question is not necessarily that because we have now talks with Hamas, it is a victory for Hamas. This is a kind of a very poor victory. Hamas is in a very poor shape, and this is actually why they initiated the demonstrations and the balloons and the other things. The question is, how can we really stabilize the situation, not exactly as it was in the past when the agreements were very fragile? And what I'm saying is that we do have a partner which has more or less the same aim, and this is the Palestinian leadership in Ramallah. But we don't talk to the Palestinian leadership. We are trying to ignore it while talking directly or almost directly with Hamas. Although the interest of Hamas and the interest of Israel are really far from being the same. And this is something that I believe is truly wrong.
Dr. Beilin, stay with us. I want to bring into this conversation someone who lives in Gaza. We have with us Rami Aman, who is a resident there within the Gaza Strip. Sir, thanks for being with us. I want to ask you, Rami, your thoughts on this reported ceasefire deal that would open up a new shipping route, would open up the fishing zone even more, perhaps commercial crossings. Do you like this truce? Is it a good thing for you and for the people of Gaza?
Yeah, thank you so much. Yes, since yesterday, I think many people here feel that there is a change in Israeli decision, like open Kerem Abu Saleh border again and continue for the fishermen many ways so they can fish from the sea. And the people here now, they feel now there is something discussing in Egypt between Israel and between the United Nations and between the Palestinian side. And you can say now, the people here in Gaza are feeling these days that we are in the final level of March of Return. So I think, in my opinion, maybe through the coming weeks, maybe you can listen that there is no need for any kind of demonstrations at the border between Israel and Gaza Strip. But I think after of these months and after of all of these, more than 168 Palestinians killed and more than 10,000 Palestinians injured, these are leaders of Gaza Strip after of all of this situation. I think Hamas is renewing her leadings for Gaza Strip maybe these days, especially that Mahmoud Abbas al-Mazen keeps away from the control of Gaza Strip. But you can feel now in Gaza Strip that the people feeling that we are in the final level of March of Return administration.
Rami, I'm going to jump at you just because we're having some difficulty with this connection, but we did hear what you had to say. I want to ask Daniel Tsemach a question. He did mention, Rami, the importance of tomorrow, that this may be the dwindling days of the March of Return, that no longer would we need to see mass protests, violence, kite launches. It's not going to be necessary anymore. How crucial is tomorrow to figuring out how serious perhaps Hamas is about a truce?
Well, it may be important, but I don't think that it all rests on tomorrow, although if something significant and out of the ordinary happens tomorrow, let it be a rocket launch or something of that sort, that might prove to be very consequential. But just last week, these talks were still ongoing, did not seem to fail as we understand now, and there were 9,000 Palestinians protesting fairly violently along the border, as well as Palestinian casualties and injuries, over 20 from what we understand. So that was a pretty violent day last Friday, and the talks continued. The talks also continued through 200 or more rockets being fired, as well as 150 Israeli airstrikes. So it might take a lot to break this round, but until it really is said and done, we can't really know for sure how this really will move forward and if the Palestinians that have been protesting will get what they've been protesting for.
Dr. Beilin, what Rami was saying on the phone from within Gaza, he mentioned that this is a good thing, but he also mentioned this appears to be a Band-Aid, that this is not a comprehensive long-term solution that would really help the people of Gaza escape from this crushing poverty, lack of electricity, lack of water. It's still a very real issue every day. What is the best comprehensive plan moving forward? Do you agree that this is just a short-term Band-Aid? Can it lead to something better?
Yeah, I do agree that it is short-sighted and that we are not speaking here about a real consequential action which will change the situation on the ground, make the life of the Palestinians more tolerable there in the Gaza Strip, and the Israelis who live around the Gaza Strip also in a much more secure way. It may help, it may, whether Friday is becoming a very important day tomorrow or not. I agree that it is not so important. It may be better a little bit, but this is not the real change. The real change is a plan for Gaza, which we know, by the way, which has been prepared not only by the UN or Egypt, but also on the Israeli side in the last years. And the big question is whether Israel or the current rightist government is ready in the future to connect the Gaza Strip to the West Bank as it is part of the interim agreement of 95, or as Israel Katz, the minister Israel Katz already said, we will never have a safe passage between Gaza and the West Bank. If this is the view of the government, if the idea is to isolate Gaza, they have to forget about a real secure situation there, about a quiet situation there in Gaza. It will all be interim for some weeks,
Dr. Beilin,
for some months, and then again we will see balloons or whatever.
Dr. Beilin, Hamas rules the Gaza Strip. Reportedly, they're not that interested in reconciliation. Why don't they give the bodies back? Wouldn't that be the key first step? Wouldn't that show how serious they are to getting humanitarian aid?
I don't want to see the seriousness of Hamas. I think that we should not have negotiations with them. I don't think that these are the people who create the address, the real address for Israel today. It is wrong to do that. And I understand why the prime minister or the defense minister deny the fact that they are talking to Hamas. Of course, we have to demand the hostages and the bodies and whatever. This cannot be a veto or a precondition for anything to quiet the situation in Gaza, but it has to be part of an overall agreement with the Palestinians.
All right, Dr.
Rather,
we have to leave it there, Dr.
A direct channel with Hamas.